Welcome to San Francisco Big Analytics. My name is Chester Chen. I'm the organizer for the event. I also work for GoPro. I'm the manager for the data science engineering. So today we have a guest from Walmart, Mr. Sun Chun Sung. He's actually my friend. So he's talking about how the DevOps practice in Walmart. But before we do that, we'd like to have Cedric, who's the senior director of a cloud platform for GoPro, say a few words about GoPro.
Oh, thank you, Chester.
Hey, good evening, everybody. My name is Cedric Fernandez, and I'm responsible for cloud engineering here at GoPro. Any GoPro customers, users here in the audience? Hey, nice, not bad. All right, so you know we've hosted a number of meetups here in the San Francisco office last 18 months or so, and people generally walk up to me and go, "Why are you guys are always talking about software when you're a hardware company?" Fact is, you can't really build good hardware today without a good software ecosystem to go with it, and that's what we're focused on here in mainly in the San Francisco office. We've built a full-blown cloud backend system that processes media. If any of you have bought Hero 5s, you know that we automatically now upload content to the cloud. It's a fully connected ecosystem. And with that comes, you know, the ability for us to actually look at all of this data in the system as well and make better decisions, business decisions going forward. And that's what Chester's team is responsible for. So the stuff you guys are talking about today is very relevant to us here at GoPro. We're hoping we learn something from what Walmart has done. I'm sure you guys will learn. Looking very forward to participating in this discussion and going through what you guys are going through here today. So again, welcome to GoPro. Thrilled to have you guys here. Enjoy the rest of the evening.
Thank you. So my name is Chun Sung Zhang. Many people just in my company, they all call Dr. Q. So it's much easier just for Q, because many people know the pronoun, but if you know what Dr. Q means, right? So in my company, they all call me Dr. Q. Today, I can talk to with different peoples, and so I don't know how I can fit your area, because I talk to many people, you are many related to the data. So I'm come from DevOps field, but I also work with data before. But I try my best to share what I learned, and also and what I think. Well, and I can answer your questions if you have. So before I just talk a little bit of something related to myself. Right? So I got a doctorate degree at McGill in Canada, and also I worked for IT for 8 years. I'm a senior IT architect. So at that time, I worked from the basic level, the network setup, and telecommunication, the phone, the PBX, narrowband, broadband, anything related to the network. I worked for IFA on the biotech after 10 years, and working on the informatics, see how the human being works, right? So why not how the network, how the computer works, but how the human being works, right? How the human being, the cell, the communication, the signal, I also work related on the informatics, related on the informatics. And I work as a GE, for the GE Digital Begin, working on the DevOps. Okay, so when I work at the GE, I work on the cloud, see how we can put the data into the cloud and how we can use the data reliably. Because the data now is very huge, changing. Right now I'm working as a Walmart. So many people say, Walmart, when I talk to my people, I say, I work on Walmart, you are the cashier, you are the So many people think Walmart is just a grocery store, right? But in fact, so Walmart back, we have all 4,500 employees working on the GEC, that means the e-commerce side. Yes, just in the central side. So something area I work at, Oracle, Central, Sigma, and also the ISO, Cloud, OneOps, Sigma. Okay, so those are something related to myself. For today, I try to work mainly on two parts. Number one is work on something things, because I don't want to just give you an introduction on what DevOps people may think is shock. But I try to say, where are we right now? Just on the internet. I don't care, you're working on the data, you're on hardware, software. So I try to begin with IoTs, okay? So things we are working on, okay? Now working on some data-related information on the internet. Then we see how we can migrate, or I can share my DevOps, and how we can move to the DataOps. Because also very hard right now, the DataOps, right? How we can maintain the data. So when I finish the data, then I see why DevOps, here is just the concept, we are getting more detailed information, DevOps, why, how, and how the DevOps works in format, and how we can convert from DevOps to DataOps. Okay, so this is just what I want to share. IoT, the things, right now it's very, very people confused, and also very, important term people talk. What it means, this we also know is called cloud, right? It's internet. Right now, what I get data from last year, I don't have new data for this year. Okay? The total data we have is 4,000 exabytes, which means what, one exabyte is 1 million terabytes. So, right? So that means this is the data we have right now, and it's still improving. So this last year data. And also within those the data we have of 50 petabytes, those information is entered by human beings, just by human enter the data. When today I take the bar and something happened, people just show bar the delay, people talking, and people sending all those information to the internet, right? So right now we are just in this area, all the data generate a lot of information. Those data means somewhere in the cloud, right? Mystery somewhere, and how we can maintain those data and how we can use those things. That's why the internet of things is very important right now. So I don't care which company you're working on, which industry you're working on, you have to know these things. So definition, the internet of things, because IoT is a system of interrelated computing device, mechanical and the digital machines, objects, animals, or people. Our human being is also a thing, okay? When I talk to people, you are a thing, people just, what I'm talking about? But because I also work with informatics, I work on a biotech company, our human being is really a machine. It's really just a pure chemical machine. So from whatever you get in you to the chemicals, what generate, what information, what data, what growth, it's just a machine. So from the same point of view, people just are things, okay? And those the things are provided with unique identifier. Each person has a unique identifier, right? So, and the ability to transfer data over a network, ability to transfer data or send information or get information to a network without requiring human-to-human or human-to-human interactions, which means right now, the internet information so easily to publish information to the internet, and also so easily to get the information back from the internet. How these things can work? I mean, let's say, because now I want to trace down these chairs, where this chair was manufactured, right? So that means later on, anything you can Google, right? So that means I want to know what the property of this chair, where the manufacturer, who was the manager of this manufacturer, all the things I can get those information out. So I need an ID first. Anything, I need an ID. Right now with IPv6, right? So right now all the internet, on the big internet, we all work on IP version 6, which means it's possible can identify anything, okay? And then we need transmissions. The things need to transmit the information to internet. Then we need a sensor to sense, right? The sense means to detect, then to retrieve. Then we need to control. Okay, so for things on the internet world, we need those things. And also, each person to be surrounded by thousands of thousands connect every day. This is the target on the 2020. So I mean, by 2020, each person, you should have 3,000 or 5,000 connected. Either iPhone, computer, or video, camera, satellite, anything they sense, you connect to internet as well. And the data, the things is so important. And here are just some steps how things can work. Okay, you have a connection, and so you have connect, monitor, then you're able to search, and you manage it, and you control it, and you play. So that means the last goal is you play with things. You can think of this is what about if you see what's going on. We're not. It's really we just play with a lot of things. Okay. So let's begin with the things. Then come to the data. The things on the internet is just a data. And how we can get the data, how you can retrieve the data, they have a lot of servers. Right now we call them micro servers. So that means a lot of companies from bioinformatics, from the GE industrial, from the Walmart, right now we create a lot of micro servers. And those micro servers is mainly you can get easily from the mobile systems. Okay, so that's why mobile, even though you are not entering your data, but they automatically provide connection to internet information, okay? So, and also the social media, the Twitter, Facebook, right? So then when you get some information, you can easily to share with the information out, and we have a lot of duplication. So right now, and even though we have a lot of so much data on the internet, but we also have a lot of duplications. Okay, so that means because of the social media, and also come to the big data, all the data there, how you can make sense out from those data look like garbage data, right? So how you can retrieve those information and make some information out. Okay, those are the big tasks for the big data, right? Then we come to the cloud, is mainly how to demand for, how to maintain those data, how to replicate those data. Because later on, the data will follow you. Okay, so wherever you go, whatever you use, you get the data right away. We don't have a computer anymore. So that's why when I first joined the industry of the computer is the mainframe. Okay, we have mainframes and people use the console, modern, so then people become micro. Become the PCs. Now the PC is gone, right? So people don't need a PC anymore. All the data, the computer application on the internet, you really don't need a PC. You just need a way to access the internet, access those services. Those called the cloud. Okay? So this cloud will follow you, right? And then we need a standard regulations, right? So that means we need to regulate that, and how we can talk and how we can share the information, so we need a standard, and we need to control the product. Okay, so now we come from the things, internet of things come to the data. Right? Here just link the connection between the things, internet of things, and the data, similar to what I talked, because I want to use this slide to introduce the DevOps. So this called using the keep calm and the collect data. This is coming from big data. Right? So they mean keep calm and collect data. So this cycle is the control, instrument, monitoring, is also like what I said, how you can use the internet of things, get internet of things, right? And also the menu with all the data information there. And when you get the data, you get the information out, then you make a decision. And how do you use the data? So here from the, now we come to what is the DevOps? Okay, so that means right now, I just like the beginning I said, I don't care what industry you are working on, what you are doing, you are working on something, okay, for example, right? So we also know the things is the data, the field is information, and what is the DevOps? So we also say keep comms and do DevOps, right? This is a similar term like we say, keep calm and collect data. And this is traditionally the DevOps. So the definition is mainly the DevOps is really cultural change. Just thinking is really a cultural change, it's not really technology, right? It's just a way of thinking, a way of working with change. Okay? So mainly is you have to respect and trust. Because you know what it means. Okay, later on, so when I get more details, so you will mean when you begin DevOps, you have to trust first. Okay. Anyone you're working on, you have to trust. Okay, you have to trust. And also you have to be transparent. Anything change is transparent. And also on the vision. So that means because why you have to trust in the DevOps, the developer, they should can be able to change into the real production. Whatever they do, it's called when they commit in, the chain automatically go to production. That's why you have to trust the developer, right? So you have to trust this. But how can this possible? Because the production, if anything wrong, they have big in value for warm up, right? So if one engineer put a defect into the production, people cannot check out. They have $1 million loss, right? So this totally comes from nation, right? So from CI/CD, we call continuous integration and the continuous delivery, CI/CD process. They just, and also the most important infrastructure as a code. This is also very popular, people saying this. Why? Because before we have only the computer, right? So when you need a powerful computer, you have to buy, you have to buy the CPU memory disk. No, you don't need this anymore. We don't have computer concept anymore. The computer in the DevOps world, it not exist. You just let me know what you need. CPU, let's say, so I need a 20 CPUs, 1 gigabyte memory. Okay, you just written the code and then you say deploy. They automatically give you all the CPU powers, memory powers, the data. Infrastructure as a code. Okay, you don't think of a computer anymore because there are no computer at all in the DevOps world. Okay, you just see what the power you need, and they are automatically adjust. Okay, so that's why automation is important. And also you have to lean. Why you have to lean? What it means is very fast. DevOps is very fast. Okay, you warm up right now, one month. Normally we deploy 1,000 deployments. So we deploy continuous changing. That's how you have to do the automation test, all the qualification, different test case, quality control, securities, right? So, and how you make sure all things work? You have to be very, very fast. So that's why we call it lean. And also you have to measure, you have to monitor, okay? So those means DevOps. Basically, it's not easy to define DevOps. You can Google through and say what is DevOps. They have a lot of definition. Why? Because they have no single answer. It's really all of those cultural change. It's a way of thinking, a way of working. Sharing, okay, so whatever we learn, that in the DevOps, we have a lot of products working on the public share, like GitHub, right? We also use a lot of open source code. Also, we use open source code, we contribute to the open source code as well, which means it's sharing, right? Because you have to trust community, right? So just like Meetup, we have to share information with each other. Why we need DevOps? So before, I have mentioned what is DevOps. Now we say why we need DevOps. Before we have development, right? You have developer, they develop code, they follow the requirement. Before you come from development to the operation take at least 6 months, okay, from all the time they work. Before Hewlett Packard, Matrix, GE, all the days, they at least 6 months or 1 year or 2 years. Right now, this is the DevOps here. So you can continually deliver your software, deliver the features, right? So that means right now the internet changes so fast, right? And also less complex problems to fix. Before, why people cannot deploy that fast? Because it breaks. People, you know, there's some defect and it breaks. That's why people are scared to put this code into the production. And you put it there, you break it, you have to fix it. But now, and how you can make sure the code not break. Means if we feel something very difficult to deploy, what do you do? Well, I have a feature very difficult to deploy. What do you do? Before we have to fix, we have to do a lot of tests, right? In the DevOps world, just deploy more. If they deploy, continue. That's why they have CI/CD. When you continue to deploy, and you make that so easy, right? Because you just change a little bit. do something wrong. You know this problem, this needed fix. So that's why CI/CD is very important for DevOps. And also, it's much faster resolution for the problem because you know what changed. And what is a small change. Okay, so that's why it's very fast. For the benefit of the business, you can say it's very easy and fast to deliver the features. And how to deploy the mainly those four things. So like I mentioned, DevOps is a culture, okay, is a way of working. So number one, how to do it deploy for the company, you can say here the loop, but you need a collaboration, work for many teams. That's why the DevOps, we are looking for DevOps. Engineer, right? It's so difficult to find one. Why? Because we have to know the collaborator, all the team from the top level security, right? From top level business, from the IT, okay, from the developers, from different feature in the business, and we have so many teams that work together, right? And also you need a continuous testing. Continuous testing many times is not easy. I know. Sometimes we have used production as a test environment. So now if you go to some website, you may find out, especially in the internet, a lot of websites, you can see sometimes not working, sometimes feature not working. Why? Because all the companies, they use production test. Why? Because it's a microservice. It's very difficult to set up a test environment that can integrate all the microservices together. You have to test in production, right? So because we have the data so big, you don't have a good integration environment to test your product, which is impossible. So we have to test production in the real production world. That's why you can say sometimes the website is working, sometimes not working, right? Because they're doing continuous test, and also continuous release deploy and continuous monitoring. So those are how we do it. And also how we have to agile. This is the old ways to work with the development, right? So we have waterfall development, so you have the feature defined, and you work on feature delivery, then you get the code, so working, test, when you finish, you check in, and you check again, and you release. It's called waterfall. Okay, but this was in old ways, right? So it's very slow and also very expensive, especially for the hardware side. And so you have to get all the hardware, so you have to define hardware, because you don't know how many people need your applications, what's the customer, what's the bandwidth, what's the transmission rate. You don't know, you have to buy enough. And sometimes you waste a lot of money, right? Especially also for database. So the new ways will become dynamic. So then it's easier to learn. Whenever the feature post put in, we already test. So that means before you written your code, we already written our test code, we already written our development code, deploy code, even the hardware, we already written those code. So that means whenever you code in, automatically test and deploy. So this one agile. Okay. Whenever you change all things, why? The whole thing is as a code. Whole thing is controlled by code, not by hardware. Yeah. In DevOps world, we don't have computer, whole thing is the code base. And we can use to run the dynamic. The computer CPU memory is a dynamic increase, right? And also the 7x24 support. Okay. So this is what we are working on right now. So what about DevOps? So I put on the Internet of Things and also DevOps. Now, Google search is other very hot topic called DevOps. How we come from the DevOps process, whatever I just show you all the process, transfer them into a DevOps. Right? So we can produce a lot of data. So here just say data is not only considered as an asset for competitive advantage. Before I own the customer data, I own a market, right? But now it's not anymore. But now a security asset for competitive survival. So now it's not only advantage anymore, it's a survival. You have to own the big data. So So that means for any company, you only provide product. Without the data coming in, it's very difficult for you to know what's going on in the market, right? Because so fast, the market changes so fast, the product changes so fast, right? So if you don't have the data coming in, the feedback in, the company is very difficult to survive. So that's why they call it data off. Here I just quickly go over a little bit because I don't want to, from CIO, so now some position is called open, we have CIO called CEO and CEO. That means if the company, you can say people began pay more attention to the data before they all called CIO, right? Chief Information Officer. Why? Because they control the whole IT infrastructure. Hardware, software, the networking, the pipeline, right? It was called CIO. Now, a lot of companies they began have called CDO, Chief Digital Officer, which means they control all the data officer, analyze all the marketing, right? Because this is a very, very big market. Also very important for the company's survival. So the data is much more important. Okay, so I'll just quickly go over. The CIO will become a DevOps, and the CDO become a data ops. Okay, okay, let's do a compare between the DevOps and the data ops. Okay, so data ops, the DevOps mandatory enable system developers and manager to handle modern web-based application development and deployment. The DevOps still focus on the dev part. Okay, even though we all have ops, right? But we still focus on the dev part. But you set up process enable the developers or managers to develop their application for features put in the market very efficiently and fast and reliably. So infrastructure requirements need to support the quantity, performance, demand, and the diversity of the system available for modern enterprise. So basically, you support all the requirements from the manufacturer of business and hardware requirements. For the data ops, mandatory enable data professional to optimize for modern web-based data storage and analytics. Okay, so this is for the data ops. Also, you need to support a highly scalable, high available, diverse type of data. That means the data is changing every day. So if you monitor the company network, you can see the data and how can data out, how you can provide scalable and reliable, right? So database, and even though you know the we call it garbage in, garbage out, so many people put the data on the cloud. You can put some data or bad data, garbage data into the cloud. The cloud replicates, right? So that means I send to your account and you forward to other people. So data replicate loosely. We call it broken data and bad data, whatever. And how you can filter them out and how you can detect them out. Right? So that means how you can make those data available and also diversify of data types. The data sometimes is not easy to figure out what information you can get. Right. So here is the top 10 DevOps companies in the world right now. So Amazon, Netflix, Adobe, Fidelity. So you can see Walmart, not strong. So this company here, and also the easy. So you can see many those commercial companies, they spend a lot of money on DevOps. Is better for Amazon, Netflix, right? So those companies and they spend a lot of infrastructure or the process for DevOps. Walmart. Okay, so far I just quickly gave an overview from the Internet of Things, come to the data, then come to the DevOps, come to the data ops. Okay, now I come to Walmart, say what is specifically for Walmart and how Walmart for those process, right? Walmart, you all know the Walmart, but you may not know the history of Walmart. Basically, basically save money and live better. So many people say, Walmart is cheaper, right? Yeah, this is the goal. This is Walmart goal is just how you can save money, right? So you can live better. And so this is the foundation in 1962, and we have 2.2 million associates. We employee because associate. So I think this is the and also for the travel, for the e-commerce, we have e-commerce in 11 countries. We have 198 million users, okay? And also we have 1,000 deployment per day in Walmart.com, right? So if you go to Walmart, every day we have 1,000 deployment changes. All the features, in online, so that's right. And 27 now, we just get new site play to work, so you very good place to work. So in Walmart, the process, we come to the edit of the DevOps in Walmart. So basically, we based on automation, quality, and deliveries. First, because we work on the DevOps, right? So then before your development, you have to be based on the test driven method. So this is also very important. Before we define what we need, okay? Before you written a really code to function this feature, you have written a test. How to validate this feature? How to validate this code? We call it test driven. Before you written a real function code, you have written test code. And also we use tools to monitor unit test, the line coverage, condition coverage, because when you write the code, you can go to a different branch, right? So then we have a test for different environment. And also we control all the code qualities. So before you check in, we all based on the Git. Okay, so we have own GitHub, right? So then it's and we have official Git and for the team, for the feature team, you have a fork in the Git first. Okay, you call the fork on the Git. Then you work the team working on the fork, the team. Individual engineer, you work on your own Git. So you clone right, and you work on your feature, you create your branch. And you check in your fork, then you pull request. You merge all the code into the real integration environment. Okay, so then this is, but you also have, we have a lot of tests going on. Before any code you commit, you have a test on your local. When you merge or when you push the code into the fork repository, they have their own agile environment, CI/CD you can do the test. When you finish your own feature agile test, you can pull the request to the centralized integration environment and have integration test. And when you finalize this one, then put it in the production. So we have a lot of tests between you and the code. We call the code promotion from your lower levels. Level, every stage, we have a lot of continuous tests. Now, then we go to the CI, means this on the official, when you pull request, the code comes to the official repository. Then we control the CI. Okay, we have a CI for the agile environment, also we have CI for the integration environment. Means it's real control environment. For the agile environment, is controlled by teams, but this agile For the integration environment controlled by DevOps, because which is very close to the production. And so DevOps control integration environment. So the CI, whenever we finish the CI, then we do the C continuous. So normally we call build once, we promote the code promotion, right? So then all the code can be if they pass, we put a tag, okay, we put those we call artifactory into it. Special place and tag it. And this tag, the artifact, will be promoted to the production. If something wrong, okay, so we will also call the green test or A-B test. If something wrong, we go back quickly. Right? So that's how the CI/CD works. From code getting in and to the production, they may take only less than 30 seconds. And so all the process going very, very fast. If something wrong, then you go back. I know in Google, because I also talked about this, some in Google, Facebook, they have one single branch. They don't have multiple branches. they all have a single question. Any features? Format, we have not come together today yet. We still have a parallel branch. In Google, Facebook, they have only single branch. Anyone checking the code to a single branch. For the features, if not designed to release next week or so, you don't disable this feature with a special tag. But you can test with this special tag. So then even though code into the production, you will not function because you not enable it. But you can test, right? So that means all the code only contains only a single code. All the production code is the latest code. They need a lot of discipline, need a lot of trust, right? But even working so fast, whenever you enable a feature, you just turn on the feature. Don't need to deploy because the code are already there. You just turn on the feature is on. That's why in the last month, so we call it DB style. And all the motions, artifacts, all this are already pre-configured. All the code product on the production. At that moment, 9 p.m., they turn on automatically. So that's why if you check closely, 8, the press to the very high, but right now to the 9 p.m., press check, right? Okay. This is all the production code is set, just depend on the time, depend on the feature, you can turn on automatically. So this is how they do the CI/CD process. So this is the format of vision. So we come to the dev of the involved two parts, one is the dev, one is the op. Previous slide is show you dev, and here show you op. It's op, and then it's also, because like I said, obviously nothing you do will ever mean anything unless people use it. Don't care how good the feature you develop, but if the user cannot see or cannot use that feature, it's useless, right? So that's why operation is last check, and this the customer is last validation if the feature works or not. So the operation manage to make sure you have smooth transaction from the integration environment to the state environment, we call it pre-production environment, and also to the production environment, because we want to make sure all the process is going. The most is the state-driven decisions, so the quality checking, because we all check metrics, how many users can connect, what database connection, what the performance. Now we can enable or disable this deployment also. And also, it only takes once to look at customer. Now, the customer is very picky, so then if you slow or some function not working, people just go to another company, right? Go to other side. So that's why it's very, very important to lose customer is very easy. You gain customer in order to, but if you lose a customer, it's so easy to lose a customer. You slow. If they cannot check out, they cannot pay. And anything features, customer can go. Here just began a little bit of technology side. Before we talk about the process, now we come to the technology. In the DevOps, we mainly, from the source control, we mainly based on the Git or GitHub. So this is also open source, right? On the build, we mainly use the Maven build. And now we are slowly moving to because it's much easier than Maven to control the process, control the process, right? And when they finish the build, all the artifacts will be delivered to a centralized location called. We are using the so here to control all the artifacts, whatever you do, the website, the jar file, WAR file, right? So all the things is ready for the protection. Now we put it in this artifact. We have snapshot, we have release. As all the artifacts promote through here, which one to choose into the production and depends. Depends on the type, depends on the feature, depends on the features of all the artifacts, and those we call the artifacts. We have a robot, also very easy to go back. You just pick up this one, copy it over, and then start up. Right? So you can do the program very easy. Then you use the console to monitor, okay? So you control. And here, then we're using the Chef, Happy, and now in 1 month, we are using OneOps to deploy. Here just some reference for you, the DevOps tools on the market right now. So it basically is similar to what we are use. GitHub, source control, CommunityOCD, many of Jenkins, right? And Go was also used. Also Unitas, Google, JUnit. Now we have cloud, and they're using the deploy in Azure, virtual machine. So similar process, okay? So just sure. So now we come to a specific one-offs. So one-offs is a platform. One-offs is a company which was founded in 2011 bought by Walmart in 2013. So one-off is the open source code. So it's open source code developed platform for cloud and application lifecycle management. Also, it works with multiple parties. So specific difference between one-off and Amazon cloud, Microsoft cloud, Google cloud. One-off is open. So one-off is work with multiple public and private cloud platforms. Okay. So it includes Microsoft. So they don't have specific requirements. You can use any cloud like. Also, you can build up your own cloud easily. Okay. One-off also work with the human database, RDMS, NoSQL database, also Electro, Argos, and also integrate with the enterprise editing service, so you can have a single sign-off. So that means when you single sign-off can work all different clouds, you don't need multiple sign-off. You can do the quality control and the configuration. And so they have very tightly control the security. Who can do what? Because one-off touch production. So anything you do here, you touch the production, so they can control, very tightly control who can do what. Easy to control. And also, one of is related to the public at the beginning of this year. So it's totally public. So, right now, one of is based on OpenStack. Right now, it's running, one of running is 170,000 cores right now. So, many have more than 1,000 users. So you can see here the status. So, and also they come with auto repair, auto replace. So when you use one-off to deploy the applications into the cloud, whenever something wrong, they automatically repair. You see something wrong, and also the process is wrong, they auto repair. And also if really something bad, and they cannot repair, right? They can have repair, they cannot repair, they auto replace. Just second, so it's very fast replace. So you just use that in second to replace. So technology wise, let me check the time. Let's make sure we don't learn. Okay, so the design of the one-offs, and they have some old technologies, but they also have some new ones. So they have Ruby, Chef, Tomcat, and Node/Slash. And also, the design is mainly to have some concept called, begin with assembly concept. Okay. Assembly is any application like www.walmart.com is assembly. It's whole things, right? So then you can design anything as assembly. Assembly is independent workspace where applications are managed. Then you can design. So they have design transition. So the design phase is how do you set up all the requirements. Okay, so that means you can have, we call it template. You can design template, they say for Walmart.com, this way for, we all also work on Sam.com, how to get that. So you can design the whole thing. And the transition I can fine tune, I can use this design. But let's say for US, I have those features. For Canada, I have other features for European. Right? So you can have different settings in the transition, but you can use the same design. If you change one thing in design, they publish for all the time. So transition. So they don't care US, Canada, Brazil, anywhere they go. But you can maintain it to the specific region. The transition vision is you can manage it. assembly is hold everything together. The design is all the features, components, hardware, and transition is the function of your environment. Operations and monitoring and control. The benefit is similar to what we talked about before. So you have a design architecture, okay? And all your and you have a transition, how to convert the architecture to the real environment, right? So the real environment, and then how to monitor your environment. More technical, so they have a user interface, they are Java based, and have a configuration database, operation database, and many they have message, but they have lots of message queues, a lot of communication with different environment, different instance, they all come with message bus, and it will come up. It's more technical, so I think we don't have time to talk more technical. So here just show one of work for different environment, and also it's very simple. You just, for the developer, you can normally, I imagine, you can download one of the GitHub, okay? You download it, you compile it, and you can run on your laptop. On my laptop, I can run one of. Basically, they need a tool, CPU, and 8 gig. That's it. You can get all one of. If working, then you can deploy. You can set up a cloud on your PC. You can set up using your watch box, right? Or dark, right? So now you can have all the data become the cloud. Then you can use one of to control the cloud for test deployment. CI, CD, process, deployment, build the whole thing. You can source code, build, testing, deploy. The whole process, whole pipeline is set up on your PC. So that's why you can, or you can also go to the AWS or just use the Docker build out. So it's very easy to set up a connection. And now I just go through a little bit on the detail, all the steps required to set up the environment for one and how to use one. So you can see how easy it is to use. Basically, whenever you compile, you download the source code, you compile, then you up. First, you need to sign up. Okay, you can create a username, you set up. Then you create an organization, right? Like one organization. So you have a user. User again create your organization. Organization, and you have your cloud. Okay, so you can define my cloud. I can use Azure, Microsoft cloud. Just give a name. You design what is my cloud for my organization. Or you can use my data. So now you can use the Docker, use my laptop. And here you can say the cloud tag, you can define OpenStack, or the Docker, or Vagrant, or VirtualBox, anything can become a cloud. So then now you have a cloud, what service you need for this cloud, because the cloud is popular, but service is not useful, right? So you have to define So define the cloud, then you see define what service you want, then you connect your cloud service to the real cloud, either your PC or AWS or the Microsoft cloud, where you just need an API port. So take it, PC means I'm using my local PC as a cloud, and I provide all the cloud service. Okay, then you begin.
Service
is you define in the cloud. You build up a cloud. What service you provide? I say I provide database. I provide DNS. I provide security. I provide firewall. All those called cloud service. Here we define whatever cloud service you need. And you link to the cloud. And then one up, just to use, configure those service. And we deploy that. So, you see, we create a organization, we build up cloud, we define what service we need, then we build up assembly. Assembly, like I mentioned, is the whole thing of you have to put your application in. So when you define assembly, you can define, including the platform. In my assembly, what I need, right? So I need a database, I need my file system.
because all you need, right? So I need a log, I need a cron job, I need a host name, I need a polyportable domain name, I need a database, right? Here it's automatically show all the connection, all the components in the one ops and how they work together. It's a transition. So when you finish the design, on the transition part, you also can define how many clouds you have. You can define a primary cloud on that cloud. Also, I can define a secondary cloud. Because normally, each company has given a data center. I have data center on the east, but I also have data center on the west. Even one data place, one data center down, another data center on the west. So that means that you always have a primary and secondary data center for the cloud. Use, then you can define different what the weight. Okay, so and now they are safe. So then I said, well, I will deploy both at the same time. Primary time. Okay. So it's something you can define locally, even though the architecture, the design is the same. But the first specific region, you can define how you deploy your own cloud. And here, when you finish things, they have deployed plans. When you do the transition, you pull the design first, you pull the design for the architect, and you customize your transition, and you say deploy, and click deploy, and they set up all the deploy plans, so you can review all the steps. They give you step by step. So you can review, you can modify. When you finish deploy, you just deploy automatically. Monitor. So the deploy sometimes is not difficult for us. Most the challenge deploy sometimes is not work you have a method depend on investigation. How you monitor one of they have their own internal monitor component. So they will monitor automatically and also you can define some rules for how to work with your device. Let's say for example here they have auto repair. And auto replace, right? So that means auto repair is enabled. So that means you can enable anything wrong there according to your design, according to your action. If you try to send you something other, what can we just redefine it again? Try to repair it. If sometimes you cannot together the menu, because we have some API process and we have database connection locked, sometimes the issue. Lock this process frozen. And then they try to talk. API traduce, and also they try to disconnect all the database connection. They still not work. Let me just kill the process, restart the process again automatically. And because auto repair, and still cannot repair. I mean, then they will auto replace. And the whole environment is replaced from your design. Just come down and replace. Okay, so those ways make sure they always, you know, that they always have exactly the same as what you design and you do the transaction. And also they do the auto scale, so they depend on the, basically we depend on the memory usage or the CPU process. So if you also, let's say, when the CPU over 80% for over 2 minutes, I get another instance up. Okay, right? So then you can depend on the rule here. So they do the auto-scaling. So they can automatically scale up more instantly depending on the performance. So, and also with auto-replace, you can disable auto-replace. Why this one? Because sometimes you want to auto-replace and sometimes you do not work. Because when the auto-replace, they may have some issues and you don't want to broken machine will get a traffic because when you put this online, they take the information back, right? So that means sometimes we will disable the auto. We can do that. Normally, in the real production, let's say the large stadium, we disable auto replacement. If something machine is broken, don't fix. Why? Because you do not want to interrupt, you don't know what's going to do. You do not fix because whenever we have more requests come in, we get a new instance automatically, right? So it's repeated order on the base, but we enable all those build files. We can all those build up. Then later we can fix what's wrong. In the normal production, you want to enable order the base, but in certain events, the time very sensitive, you don't want to enable this. Because you don't know what happened, and it's not particular, if something goes wrong. Monitoring is also a central part of Google, so they have internal, you can monitor log, you can monitor database read and database write. They all inside of your Google system. Okay, so I think I just quickly go over. Now I just came back with a new campaign of the Internet of Things. Okay, because this I think is most important. I think is also what we are working on. Right? So I don't care. You can see all the companies here, they're mainly working on the Internet of Things. Right now, you are working on the device, you are working on the data, you are working on the information, you are working on application, whichever you are working on, you are working on some Internet of Things. Those are a lot of companies. We basically work on this thing. This all something to change, right? So you can see big data, and this is not, like I said, the customer experience is getting more and more, right? Because now, whenever you go to any website, any company, example, Walmart, whenever you log on to Walmart, you change, you have a session up. And this session is twist up. So let me see. We collect all the session information and we can play back whatever you have done. So the user data, just like what I mentioned before, say the user data is not advantage anymore, it's a survival. So you have to get the customer data. And the customer, you can see the trend getting more and more important. Because those are, you can know the market, you know the people behaving. You know, people thinking of things is how we can get those customers. And the market is big. So those are in billion dollars. So those are the things in billion dollar market. And again, it's the last slide. I think for the device, for the information, for here, the DevOps. So DevOps goes to all the kind of from the things, device. Into the automations, applications, I'm not sure if this all fits you need or not, or what you is interesting to you, but this is what I will share with you, just what I learned and what I think. And I will show you if you have any questions. This is a blue, yes. You mean the blue green is the CSV device.
When they're running both versions at the same time, you slowly stage load this?
No, blue green is I have one old version working on. I put a new version in, right? When I put the new version in, I put some test. They do a lot of test. If the test will fail, then old version, this one will back out. If the test will pass, then I just so the both are to the sorting and to the sorting chain. All the new family become to the new one. All the one will be able to slowly reduce the right. So whenever I say the day one day old for today, all the one will back down the green now. It's called progress. So that means at a certain time is so we have two run at the same time. And then all the ones will be
separate environments. We want to run like a microservice, we grab the version and we want to programmatically control the load to it.
Yeah, so they all call it routing. When you know the cloud, they have a routing. Depending on the UI, say, I say I have www.roman.com product one equal one, right? So I have this little UI point of microservice. And I can do this router thing. Right now, the real production code is open. I also have a new point to onto the new version of Kubernetes.
Make sure to repeat the question.
The question is how to support the blue deployment. How to make sure that the new version is working on the old version.
So my question is around data ops. So when you have a blue-green deployment, you want to test your new version. So in terms of data pipelining or data warehouse, where you would send the events from the new version, which data warehouse do you use? Which data pipeline?
The question is about how I can test my new version of data.
Where's the data?
Yeah. The data may be the same. The data depends on how you put the data, right? That depends on the service. You mean you deploy the new data, right?
No, if you deploy a new version, and then you have users, for example, entering Walmart, buying new stuff, right? So then you report events to a data warehouse, and then you start querying it to see how the new version is working, or how do you determine if it's working?
Yeah, the production-wise, the real production is to point to the old deployed temporary. But the new versions, we have a test environment. We have a test environment where you use the new data. Where can the user request the picture, the payout, the payment, the checkout, make sure all the function works. Those are on the test environment. Okay, so they are testing the new data. I said, even tomorrow the price will change $10, right? So the testing environment test for this price of the price of this price, usually return back $10. But the real production may be $15 right now. So the testing environment will test because whenever they pass the test, then we can depend on the time, depend on the report, and we can just change it forward. So that means that all the new requests will follow to the new data.
Okay, my question was more around how do you measure it? Like, which tools do you use? Do you use Redshift, do you use a data warehouse, or do you use Elasticsearch, Kibana, like?
You know, one of the we call the lot. So that means you can put the lot. And also, I think in the transaction, so you go to the lot, depending on which service we have test. You see in the transaction, we have the same design, we have transaction, we have production transaction, and also the test. In the test, we define using this new data. So just lot is the exact lot. Instead of the warehouse.
I got a question. So just follow up that gentleman's question. Suppose if it's a read-only, the approach is fine, but what about the data that you need aggregates? And so for example, if you test,
the data should not go to the production data.
So in that case, you do have to set a two data warehouse.
No, because test, we have our test data, so we have our test data, we have a test environment, and so they were actually getting some data, and so they will do some tests. The test data will not go to the
Yes. So what sort of big data technologies that one is using to process the big data? Is one using like Hadoop or Storm technologies?
Hadoop, yes.
The test amount, we get a response.
Okay, you mean the data may be the same. You know, as your environment, you may not have the production data, which is the same. Yeah, so that's why we also have ways, sometimes once a month or once 2 months, you want to clone the production. So if not a real production data, it's a production scheme with all the properties, catalog, all the information into Azure environment. So then Azure environment should have up to date for the production data. Also, if for this specific feature, if they don't have this feature in production yet, we have to manually create those features into the Azure environment. And so make sure all those features that you have ready.
I guess my question should be like the interaction between the e-commerce and the customer.
Okay.
So because we have the new feature in the development area, but the customer is like, the information that we get back from the customer is from the production side. So how can we quantify the benefits from the development side?
How you can quantify? So pointed out that customer even not have as well. Yeah, so we don't have simulation. So we have auto typing which generates the users calculate automatically. We have our automation or we have to smart statement as well. Just simulated because of all the behavior, the user created this one, we have to automatically using the automation. Yeah, so we have to simulate the real.
Thank you so much, Dr. Q. Thank you for coming.